Back in the electrical workshop, I'm back with Marcus. Yep. So what are we up to, Marcus?
So today we're going to look at our second dead test, Gaz, which is continuity of our ring final circuit.
Okay, I've done a few videos on the channel before with a few popular misconceptions because it's the way I teach it. We're going to go through by the letter of the law this time,
are we? Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to carry out the ring final circuit test stage by stage. We've got a whiteboard all set up to do our calculations. We've got none of that fancy whiteboard that Joe brings in with the We're going to do it by pen and by hand. Yeah. So we're going to bring the camera in. We're already isolated. There is no supply in the installation. We've got our cables all out. We'll show you how we've identified our conductors. And then you'll set about, how many stages is there to the test?
Three stages.
Okay, so we'll set about stage one. Okay, let's get in front of the comments before we get there. This is a training rig. These come in and out hundreds of times in a week. And obviously they look like this. We're not concerned about that. We're concerned about doing our end-to-end tests in order that we start proving our ring final circuit. We've shown you how to set up a mega MFT many times on the channel. This is a level 3 video, so we're not going to show you this time how to set it up. We're ready to go, and we're going to concentrate on doing these stage one readings, and I'm going to record it on the board this way.
So first of all, we obviously have stage one of continuity of our ring final circuit. Now, the values we obtain from this are our little R1, our little Rn, and our little R2. So as I'm going along, we're going to have to record these, one for a calculation we're going to need for the later stages, and also these will appear on our schedule of test results. So I'm going to go between my line conductors first. Okay, and by doing this test, we're confirming we have a ring final circuit, and I get a reading of 1 ohm. I'm then going to go between my little Rn between my neutral conductors, and because they're the same length and the same cross-sectional area, I should actually get around the same reading. Now, there's been a misconception sometimes in regards to a plus or minus allowance of 0.05. Now, that is actually for this stage, not for the later stage 2 and stage 3. So is that within my 0.05 tolerance of 1 ohm? It is. So I'm happy that 0.98 ohms is satisfactory. I'm now going to go on to my CPCs. Now, the thing to note here is because we've got it wired in twin and CPC cable, our CPC is sized at 1.5 millimeter squared, and our line and neutral conductor, so our live conductor, is at 2.5 millimeter squared. Now, what that means is we would expect the CPC end-to-end values to be 1.67 times greater than that of our live conductors. So if we did the calculation 1 ohm times 1.67, we should get a value of 1.67 ohms.
Difficult maths there. I'm loving your style, Marcus.
Normally Joe's thing. I'm not very good at maths. We've got 1.68. Again, I would be happy with that. Oh, and it's just dropped to 1.67 ohms. So again, it's spot on. And one of the things I like when I deliver this in the classroom is learners find it magical when that calculations actually work. Now, by doing that, that is our stage one complete. And again, we are confirming now that we have a ring final circuit, and we're recording that on our schedule of test results, and we're going to use them for the later stages in our figure of A tests.
So that's stage one of the ring final circuit test done. I've recorded on the whiteboard these results you've given. We'll do a calculation in a minute. We're now going to be linking opposite conductors to each other. It's quite easy to see them in twin and CPC, which is one set of three and which is one set of three. But you've also done something extra in order to identify the conductors, Marcus.
Yes, so what we've done is we've actually added a little black mark with a black marker pen to one set of the legs for easier identification.
I love that. There's one on there, and one on there of a set of three. And it makes it very easy when we start doing this figure of eight test next. So while I've been busily doing some calculations on the whiteboard, Marcus has joined together opposite line, opposite neutral, opposite line, opposite neutral. Okay, so we've got one side here with a black dot on the actual neutral and one black dot on the line conductor to confirm they're opposites. What are you going to do now for me?
So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to take our first measurement, and when we look at the calculations, this should line up with our calculations so we know what to expect. We're going to take that from the connector blocks themselves before we go around the circuit, plugging in with our socket adapter.
Okay, so I've done a calculation, and it may have popped up on the screen or not, but I did a calculation. I've got this as rounded up 0.05, so that's quite nice. However, at this stage, I would normally say, oh, it's got to be within 0.05 of the reading that we calculated, but that's not the case. We know that.
No, yeah, that is for stage one. This one now is important. When we plug round, we should know what to expect as general wear and tear, and what maybe is a high resistive joint that could cause issues when it comes to ADS and things like that.
I always kept mine within that value of reading, which I've done in previous videos, because it was a great reference point for learners. But we've grown up now. This is a level 3 video, so we've got a reading there. We expect to replicate a very similar reading at all our socket outlets. Is that correct?
It is correct, yeah.
Okay, so as you've got your probes in your hand, I see you've gone for the fuse connection unit first. I can only see one cable, so what's going on there?
So I've gone for the fuse connection first of all, just for the simple fact is I had my probes connected in my tester anyway.
Okay.
As you can see, so rather than keep chopping and changing, I'm just going to come to this first. When I've took the front cover off, like you said, you notice you only see one set of cable. So this indicates to me at this point that it's actually a spur off of one of these existing socket outlets. So I'm going to check it here first, remembering that because it's a spur, I've actually added in resistance to the circuit. So I expect this to be higher than my calculated value for my big R1 and my big RN.
Okay. So let's have a little look. And it is, yeah. So that's considerably more than the calculated 0.5 and our measured, well, I think it was 0.51.
Was yes, it measured? Was, yeah.
So that's logical because it's come from a socket that should have that value and added the resistance of the additional cable. We believe at AM2 and AM2S, there is a ring final circuit with a fuse connection unit on the ring.
Yes.
It's vitally important that you take the cover off and test the fuse connection unit, whether it be at the assessments we do at college or the one for AM2 and AM2S. Where are you going to next, Marcus?
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to swap over my leads now to a plug-in adapter, and then I'm going to go around the ring final circuit plugging into all the outlets.
So off camera, me and Marcus have set our instrument up. I've got the red and blue into the top of my instrument, and Marcus got the plug-in end. And what are we doing now, Marcus?
So now we're going to go around and plug into all of our socket outlets. While I'm doing this, I'm going to ensure that I'm operating the switch. This is confirming part polarity. Now by this, I mean we're identifying that the bottom two contacts align and neutral. However, at this stage, we're not confirming that they're in the correct position. So I'm going to operate the switches.
So we've got a spot on reading there.
Yeah.
This is incredible.
I'm reading, and I'm going to both sides. Now it's important to remember that for our big R1 and our big RM, we don't actually record this on the schedule of test results itself. However, I believe it's good practice, and I always do it on site, is on the back of the scheduled test results, I write all three stages down, and it helps the next electrician who comes along. They can see that you what the value should be.
It's a little higher on this one. Is there anything we can do maybe to improve the electrical contact there?
Yeah, it could just be a slight sign that the contacts are becoming warm.
Oh, perfect.
And now it's gone back to normal.
The reason we have a problem here on college is that we never really have any current going through them and any voltage across the pins, do we? They don't
quite
self-clean as such. Making and breaking arcs, etc. Whoa, really high.
Yeah, that one's very high. Okay. So we can plug in and out a few times. We've got some contact cleaner, But again, that is still a bit too high for me. I would replace that socket outlet.
Shall we try the contact cleaner to show what we mean by hand that?
Yep.
Okay, yeah, so you put some contact cleaner on there like that. Oh, as if by magic. Yeah. Fantastic. That's again because these never get used, and they never get the in and out of a regular plug top or a voltage across them. Wow. A little high.
Again, one slightly too high. That magic contact cleaner's coming out.
Come on, let's try a little squirt of that, see what happens. Okay, so I've got some contact adhesive. Thank you to one of my students who brought that in. That's still a little bit high. No, that's great.
Yeah, it's close enough to be happy with that result.
Okay, brilliant. Yeah.
And again, now for our stage two between line and neutral, I'm happy with all of the results that we've got from these socket outlets.
So next, Marcus, are we going to link together opposite line and opposite CPC in our consumer unit and repeat the test?
Yes, we are, and that's going to be our stage three of our ring final continuity test.
Let's move to the consumer unit next. So I can see you've changed over in the consumer unit. Now we've got opposite line and opposite CPC to opposite line and opposite CPC. We're going to take a measurement across here. I can tell you that I calculated this to be 0.67. So let's see what the measured value is.
Okay, so we're going to go across our connector blocks again. We've got 0.63 ohms.
Okay, that's fine.
Again, that is close enough for me.
Okay, that's fine. And ignore the other things that we've talked about. That's fine. We're going to be moving on. And where are you going to start doing your first test at?
So we're going to go back to our fuse connection unit and test there because we've got our probes in the test already.
Ready when you are then, Marcus.
Yeah, so we're going to go on to our fuse connection unit first, but this time I'm going between line and CPC. Now, remember that the highest reading we obtain now from this stage is going to be recorded on our scheduled test results.
We've got 0.88 ohms. We know it's going to probably be the highest because it's the spurred point.
It is, yeah. So we've added that resistance, like we said earlier, it's going to be hot.
How did you prove polarity of that outlet?
So of this outlet, because I've got the front cover off, I can actually visually confirm polarity, which is what I've done. The line conductor is going in the line terminal, the neutral conductor is going in the neutral wind terminal, and the CPC is going in the CPC terminal.
Okay. We need to change it over now in order to be able to plug into each of the socket outlets. So we'll change the leads over for the next stage.
Yep.
So a small issue in the edit, we've lost some footage, so I'm just going to interject this footage. Marcus has gone off to take his kids swimming, fair play to him. Marcus carried out the continuity CPC test here between line and CPC. He got a reading of 0.88 ohms. We're going to repeat the test at all the socket outlets. We've already tested between line and neutral. We're now testing between line and CPC. We'll complete the polarity test. We will record the highest reading. We expect all the ones on the ring to be very similar readings. So let's go round. We got a reading of 0.66. I think our calculated reading was 0.67. Operate the switch. Leave the switch in the on position for the insulation resistance test. So round I go. 0.66. Operate the switch. Reading settles in. We've got a reading of 0.66. Operate switch. Leave the switch in the on position. And round we go. Okay, fractionally higher, that's fine. Goes off, comes back on. Yep, wonderful. Off it goes, back on. Run to the next one. Turn it off, back on. Again, we've got that old contact spray if we get any issues. Remembering the highest reading, it's currently still here. Oh, fraction high there, we'll try this a couple of times. A little bit high, let's operate the switch, see what happens. Yep, that's fine, settled in. Go to the next one. Again, yeah, fine, operate the switch. Okay. So we test between line and neutral as part polarity. We tested between line and CPC. We've now confirmed the positions of the pins. First test between the two live conductors. The second one between line and CPC. By proving both of those, we've completed the polarity test at the front. We've left the switches on the on position ready for insulation resistance. The reading we just achieved when we were testing between opposite line to opposite CPC, opposite line to opposite CPC, is the reading that we're going to record of the highest value. All the readings on the ring final circuit were very similar, and we expect that. The reading at the spur, which has been taken from a socket outlet and spurred from it, had a highest reading of 0.88. That's the one we're recording our test paperwork. Let's cut to the test paperwork and see how I'm going to record the results me and Marcus achieved. Let's add our test results in. Little R1 was 1 ohm. Little Rm was 0.98. Little R2 was 1.67. Our highest R1 plus R2 was 0.88. And we did the polarity test with a tick. So while Marcus was busy going around the socket outlets and explaining how to carry out the test, Gary Vorderman was here on the board here. We recorded our little R1, our little Rn, our little R2 readings.
Yeah, and from our stage one that was.
Absolutely. And then I took and did the calculations that you described in the video.
Yeah.
These are numbers I came up with a little bit of rounding up. And I would have said in previous videos that these readings here that I calculated, I'd expect to see at every socket outlet on the ring final circuit.
Yeah.
And I've said in previous video presentations, I like to keep within that 0.05. Is that a requirement?
No, it's actually not. So the 0.05 is in relation to stage one. So our end-to-end conductors of conductors that have the same cross-sectional area.
What I was trying to do, and we had a discussion 18 years ago about this when I first came in, we were trying to give our learners a reference point for a socket on a ring final circuit. And it should be within that number. It doesn't have to be. We saw some worn sockets today. Wasn't it fantastic that when we used a bit of contact spray,
magic
spray, that we actually saw those readings fall.
Yeah.
However, if you couldn't get a reading to fall on a front plate, you're getting a really high reading. What are you gonna do about it, Marcus?
So again, you'd further investigate into the back. It could be a spur, it could be a loose connection, or it could just be the fact of wear and tear and you would replace the front of the socket outlet.
Okay, I think that's a really good piece of advice. I think we've overcome some of those popular misconceptions that I've almost introduced in some of my videos because of my historic teaching back in the all those years. So it's wonderful to have him on board, isn't it? He's going to keep producing testing and fault finding videos for you.